Hello, this I'm Reptile, and this is Mystery Commander Theater 100. I'm joined by Synergistic.
Hi, everybody.
And this is our feature video on our deck tech that we did on Rafine Seeming Skier previously. So this is the video where you'll actually get to see it in action. So yeah, Synergistic, why don't you tell me about your deck and the decks featured right now?
Yeah, so I'm playing Tatyoba Panthric Druid. It's a green fold lamp. Green-blue landfall deck, sorry, misspoke there. Trying to generate a lot of value, pretty good late game, has a lot of good interactions. We're seeing the Ur-Dragon again, which I know we've been showing the Ur-Dragon a lot. I tried my best to power it up this time, adding a lot of fast mana and tutors, so we shall see how that goes.
Mm-hmm. And then we have Dr. Vuski on Alayla, so it's just Fairies, Esper, two Esper decks. At the table, so.
Yeah, it's a lot of non-stacks espers. Is that right?
Yeah. Rafine, this build in particular really isn't a stacks build. And one thing that, if you watched our previous video on Rafine and the deck tech, one thing that I made note of was that it's really difficult to get Rafine out on turn one or turn two, and then immediately that's what I do. Just get him out.
Yeah,
get her out.
Super fast Rafine uses.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, usually you would want to just like play some other creatures. Maybe if you like have an extra sentinel, that would be a little bit more valuable to get out and slow roll your mana. But going first and just having the ability to do that, I thought, why not just get my engine down immediately?
Yeah, she's also very hard to kill, right, turn one, especially the ward one ability.
Oh yeah, that's what made a lot of this interaction really great. And what is this? A Tundra and a Mana Crypt coming out from both Resting and Dr. Vuski.
Yeah, one playing the Rhystic Study.
Yeah, the Rhystic Study gets counterspelled. What do you think about that play? I think it was pretty good, given that was just like a turn one Rhystic and everyone's going to be throwing down rocks.
Oh yeah, I think so. It's pretty good. Draws a lot of cards, especially your Dragon deck, right? It just runs out of gas pretty quickly.
Yeah.
Yeah, very specific cards to get its engine going, either that being fast mana or lands.
And here I looking to try to get my reanimator plan going. Discard Elish Norn. Feel like it would be really useful in this pod. I originally had it in my opening hand, and I decided to keep it just because of the ability to deal with fairies and then to also deal with things like Birds of Paradise. And if I could find a reanimation spell, it'd be pretty great.
Oh yeah, I chase Elish Norn. She was such a beater. One of my all-time favorite cards.
Such a great card.
I tried to miss slam her.
There.
You did miss a land drop though. Yeah,
I
you
did.
Fast
I was,
mana.
I was fishing.
Yeah, you did get a chance to look.
Lunandra Archmage, a very flashy style of card. I didn't even know that card existed before I saw it.
Yeah, I went for a greedy play here. Instead of ramping, I went for a Collector Roof since you missed a land drop and both Dr. Vuski and Resting have mana rocks. And I get super punished for it.
Super. And, just to be clear, I didn't. I made sure to float the white mana in response to the oof, as opposed to I didn't tap it while the oof was out and then let it resolve. So.
Yeah, going back to the Archmage, the Secret Lair art, it is like a Prinkle. You can spot it on Dr. Vuski's desk, along with all some other cards. So they're, come on, wizards.
Oh, the Secret Lair.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, and I still didn't get another land, but here I do have a Timna in hand, so I'm able to cycle through, deal some damage, and then actually draw a card. So really look through two, and I eventually end up getting my own Tundra. You're the only one missing out on the Tundra.
Everyone has a Tundra. Carpet of Flowers would be quite good in this pod or this table or game state, I guess.
It would. I mean, you're getting
three now.
Yeah. If you do end up getting it. Was that Tatyoba? Yeah, it's Tatyoba next turn.
Yeah. But no, we can't have nice things, so.
I'm feeling pretty good with my my value engines going on right now. I'm able to put out some damage, cycle through and get the things that I really need, and draw some cards. So. How are you feeling, especially after this?
Well, I'm feeling
we have one land.
Worst. I'm feeling I'm essentially irrelevant to this game. I do not do nothing now. I sit there now and look pretty. Yeah, look at that. Look at that considered main face.
Imagine he counterspelled it.
Oh, that was sad. We did get a land, though. Look at that island. Mm.
Oh, nice. That hollow actually looks really good at that angle. Some of the, more particularly in Dr. Vruski's board, you'll see there's a lot of glare. It also doesn't help these using the secret lair cards.
Yeah, it's like a double whammy. Resting, moving his game along, displaying some more green-blue, notably missing black and double red, which is a lot of the dragons are double red, and some of them are black as well. Nice 6-cost or 5-cost Raphine.
And thankfully that oof is not on the board, so I can actually do this. That's one thing I was thinking. I need to get, like, I wanted to save swords for, you know, something really, really like Tatiova or any of our commanders later on. But if Raphine died, I was out of the game because I was not drawing them.
Yeah. And you know, digging that ability of just like kind of looting through your decks, really strong. I mean, it looks like it's because you get rid of like all the deck cards, right, that you can't use or not relevant anymore in the game.
Yes. Oh, and there was one where I should have. I think it made a pretty big impact. It's another thing where you should just keep your mouth shut, especially if you want to win the game. He was about to copy his Glen Alondra, and he then realized that, oh, I could just get anything, and so he went for the other Esper commander that's going to let him filter. So, you know, Raphine really put in even more work than I thought this whole game.
Yeah, and I guess notably, right, the clone doesn't care about the war trigger, right, because he can say he copied of any creature on the battlefield, so it's not a target. So I think that's how that works.
Yes. So it ends as a copy of any creature. So you're not really targeting. You're just saying it's a copy of Raphine Seaman's Gear.
Yeah. So it works out. Yeah. I actually get to play a few lands this turn on a dork. So I got a Field of Dead, Nature's Lore into, I think, hopefully Tropical, and then an Elf. So, you know, I think, you know, move my plan along.
You know, that's actually, now that I think about it, maybe it wasn't that bad that you went for the oof early, because then you didn't roll out all of your mana.
Yeah, but I was, you know, that was because of the consider, right? I was pretty far behind with one permanent on the battlefield turn 3 or 2, whatever it was.
And you're, I think Raphine also showing, you know, kind of the resiliency of being able to get board wiped. And sure, I don't have my Timna anymore, but I'm back to the same game plan that I was, where discarding things that I really don't need, discard a Brainstorm. I think at this point I had Interaction, so I'm like, okay, we're entering the mid game, and Synergistic and Reston are really going to start to pop off, so I need to have the appropriate things to deal with it.
Yeah, are you digging for your combo, or are you looking for like more creatures to do aggro, just like a beatdown kind of plan?
At this point in the game, I was looking for Interaction, and it could be, you know, I could get the Thassa's Oracle, or the Tainted Pact, whichever one, find those and then just start prioritizing towards that. But I already have Elishnorn in the grave from earlier, and I feel like she would be really useful right now in terms of pushing damage through and getting rid of the problematic creatures. So yeah, I was mostly digging for reanimation at this point.
Okay, yeah, it's a good plan. Definitely war wipes me. Currently would kill Glenn Murray, the Archmage Glenn. Glen Alondra.
It kills her, and it doesn't allow her to, because I can't really use Force of Negation, Force of Will on an activated ability of a creature that's countering my Tainted Pact if I decided to go for the Thassa's Oracle combo. So I was really just trying to get rid of that Glen Alondra, and like once she was dead, I could really go into that combo. But it's kind of late at this point. That's really like something that you want to do early if you're going to try to rush it out.
Yeah, I mean, and Dr. Vruski is like getting full value out of his Raphine copy, doing kind of the same as tragedy.
Oh, it's great to see you do well, but damn, if it doesn't hurt to get beat by it.
You know, it's great to see Raphine do well. It's really sad to see that Toga being played and not a land being fouled by her being played.
That's true. Yeah, there was if I remember correctly, you had terrible luck with your lands, even though you're running a little higher than average amount in the CDH deck. So.
Yeah, it's like 34s, but no, this is a rough land economy. Real estate's really, really, really high. Gotta wait for that market to crash.
And Ranger Captain here, I was debating either going for Esper Sentinel or trying to go for one of my other combo pieces, because as I was digging, I just kept finding interaction, but I didn't really have, you know, anything to win the game. And I felt like at a certain point, you know, this landfall is going to start to really get away from me. The Ur Dragon's going to start putting things that are killing my board. So I decided to get Ballista, part of one of my combos, and I'm able to dig pretty deep with my deck. So really just getting the combo pieces and figuring out which one you wanted to do, which one's the appropriate one, was my plan here. And yeah, so connive the trick, or start conniving, start getting Myra Fiend bigger.
I mean, you did discard it, Tainted Pack, right? Right there?
I did, because I wasn't really drawing into any of my reanimation spells, and Glen Alondra, Rafine was one of the most pivotal cards against my Rafine deck, because it was putting counters on Glen Alondra, which means that any of my non-creature spells were going to get countered. So I decided, why not just go into Heliod Ballista? They're both creatures. It can't be countered by what's on board. And, you know, I have actual counter spells for the things that come towards my way. So that was my thought process in terms of getting Ballista, just be based on the board. And, you know, you haven't really played anything, and I'm pretty sure you have free counter spells as well, being in blue, so.
Yeah, I mean, and you have Heliod, right? So you have Ballista in hand that you want to search with your Ranger Captain of Eos. Now you have Heliod in the battlefield, so you need, what, 4 mana? I know you need a little bit more than that.
Yeah, and Ranger Captain also does provide me the protection against the non-creature spells, and Glen Alondra will only counter the non-creatures, and she gets underneath. Oh no, actually she doesn't.
Yeah. But you kind of dooted yourself wide open here, right? I think you're taking, what, 12 damage? Is that right? From Dr. Whiskey,
yes.
If he combines correctly.
Mm-hmm. And I had a... So right here, my thought process was, okay, Dr. Vusky, I know it's an artifact deck. He probably just has a bunch of maybe like his combo pieces that I can try to stop, and the group table would go around. I also have Mausoleum Wanderer as interaction. You know, my own form of like a creature-based counter. And I wanted to keep Ranger Captain, because if I keep Ranger Captain, I'm pretty sure I'd win next turn. So it was one of those awkward moments where just I'm going to throw it down and see what happens. I don't know if that was the best play, but...
Yeah, because now you're the main target, right? And now Heliod got bounced.
Heliod did get bounced. I was relying on the fact that he wasn't a creature and he was indestructible. And, you know, like having the Mausoleum Wander, but Teferi is a planeswalker that gets under Mausoleum Wander and it bounces it, it doesn't destroy. So I was like, man, that was a great answer.
Yeah, I like that card too. It's pretty, you know, can essentially counter spells are turned off too from everybody except Dr. Vusky. But now, if you look at my board, I finally got another land, so I got to draw one extra land. I mean, one extra card. Pardon.
Yeah, and unless you have the Mystic Sanctuary loop here, you know, there's really no threat of keeping Teferi on the board against these kind of, like, Ur Dragon's more of a mid-range value deck through dragons, and then eventually it wins through beats, and then you're a mid-range value deck that wins through infinite turns, so.
Yeah, and I think the reason this turn is taking a while is because we're kind of politicking or talking here, because you're very much like on your way out if like the whole table starts swinging at you, if you will.
Yeah, I realized that I was looking over and I was seeing, because essentially I can present win. I don't think next turn, unless I just draw like a mana crypt here and then I'm able to get the necessary amount to cast Ballista into Heliod if nothing gets countered. Pop my Ranger Captain in response, but yeah, here was the main play. I decided to play Heliod, and I told the table, I realized I was dead on board if I, you know, if everyone went at me, I wasn't really going to be able to resolve this combo because it was already so telegraphed. Mm-hmm. So I put Heliod on to gain some life back, and I discard the Ballista to, you know, kind of neutralize myself as a threat. I still have Elishorn in the graveyard, and this is one of those plays where I probably debate, like, you might as well just keep it because it's the win in your hand, but I wanted to get rid of myself as a threat while also just losing the least amount instead of trying to die.
So. Yeah, I mean, if you didn't, you're pretty much almost close to dead with Rat Blockers.
Mm-hmm. Especially if... the only thing to answer my Heliod was a Teferi. Yeah. Because that tells me that you guys really don't have... If it hits on the board, you guys have to kill me in order to not lose.
Yeah, exactly. So I guess now Dr. Fusky is taking his turn. We were reading the... what's the name again of the card?
Lanalandra?
Yeah, Jesus Christ.
It was... I think Dr. Vusky thought that it would come back with the amount of counters that it had before minus one, but it just comes back with no counters, so he...
I think negative one counter, right?
Yeah. It dies, it loses all its plus one counters, and then comes back with a negative one.
Yeah, so that was kind of what we were discussing there. And he decided not to, since that creature is pretty strong and do a lot of damage to you.
I was so happy to hear that he was gonna do that. I'm like, oh please, because that's 5 damage. Oh no, 7 damage off of me, and that lets me attack freely next turn and lifesteal, really kind of get myself back in. So
yeah, now you take, I think you take like 15 damage here, which is quite a bit. Yeah, oof. So, I mean, you're dead on board, right, to Tatioba and or the or dragon, but you know, we did make a quote unquote deal where I'm okay if the game keeps going on, because eventually I will draw lands. You'd hope.
Yeah, and this was mostly a deal because I know that Dr. Vusky is attacking me regardless. This was more of a reach out to the two other players. I essentially told them, you guys are also in a really far behind position, and if you kill me, well, then Dr. Vusky is going to just be able to, you know, like, generate this amount of value and keep Rafine and just keep this game plan going towards everyone else, so.
Yeah. Got another land.
It does work for a little bit.
So, I played another land now. It's Vesuva copying Field of Dead. I think I play a Bane of Progress. Here, I make quite a mistake. We'll see it as it resolves, which, I, from my perspective, and, you know, you can tell us in the comments below if you agree or disagree. I don't think it affected the game's outcome, just because I didn't really get to play the main lands this game in the future, and that's not super spoilery. But I, from my perspective, I don't think it affected the game. And the mistake was that you see that like, nice exploration that's just hanging out next to Tatiova?
Yeah, I see it. Yeah, it's still there, man.
Yeah, it's still there.
It's great.
Should not be there.
Bane of Progress with a Symphonic Rift on a creature.
Yeah. You know, I get to play so many extra lands with that exploration. I forgot it existed.
How many land drops have you missed at this point? You kind of just have it, bro. Have it. With this amount of luck in terms of lands, that might as well be like a carpet of flowers against Gongu deck. Sitting there, just chilling.
Yeah. Resting, having a, you know, 4 mana essentially, or dragon, pretty good card.
See it often. Great. Morphion, he has a really slow start, but I mean, he got one of his main creatures down, and he plays a Hellkite Tyrant, so out of nowhere the resting becomes, you know, one of the main targets, because if he hits anyone clean with the Hellkite Tyrant, all their creatures are dying, which is pretty unfortunate on my end, so I have to keep a blocker up.
No, that's the other Hellkite. This one takes artifacts away, which nobody has artifacts anymore because of Bane of Progress, but still a 6/5 with trample, so it's still doing a lot of damage.
Oh wow, yeah, the card can be right in front of my face and I can't even read it right. That's great.
Well, I can't say anything with the Bane of Progress, but if you read the card, it explains the cards sometimes.
And I cast a Grand Abolisher here for the sole fact that I need more creatures, and Heliod is an indestructible 5/5 that can block Bane of Progress if it decides to come at me. So cool. Sometimes you really just have to play it out your outs. I think I'm pretty sure I made a couple misplays earlier that led me to this point, but at this point I was like, yeah, this is sadly the best play.
Yeah, it might have been like the Telegraph, like Ballista Heliod.
Oh. Maybe I should have just gone for the Esper Sentinel and kept my my game plan going, just digging.
Yeah.
But honestly, I don't think Esper was really that great. There's so many, like, your lands and creatures and Vusky is just making creatures that are beating anyway, so it's not going to do anything.
Yeah. So you do swim Rafine once. You give it lifelink so you can at least get some life back. Vusk has a fairy, so he blocks with it. I think Vusk is like, you know, changed from like an artifact theme deck to just literally just go with the fairies and attack with the Raphine that you provided him and his commander that bumps flying creatures.
Yeah, it's crazy how good Raphine is in the Alayla. Yeah. I almost might consider it just as a, like a, an Esper value creature because it's pretty good. Especially for like combo oriented decks. I know that he has combos with artifacts, so it really lets you dig for the certain combos in your deck. But
right.
We'll see what Dr. Vusky chooses to do here.
Yeah, well, first things first, yeah, I go to combat. Look at three cards. Do you think Raphine would be super broken if you like draw X plus one? So you always get one card out of the deal? Would that make her super broken or?
Oh, if you were able to, like, if you got a draw on top of it?
Yeah.
You do get... Oh, yeah, yeah. Because it's, it doesn't have to be Raphine. It's any attacking creature. So it kind of ends up just being... Well, that's already one of the good things about Raphine, is it's just a selection. And here, I get swung at. Really, I think I lived with a couple of life. But I didn't have enough to block everything, and I knew I was just dead on board from the other things. The agreement was gone, and it was pretty inconsequential to just send.
Yeah, just scoop it up.
Yeah.
So I packed up the negation, the Bolas Citadel, which is a really good card in this deck. It's though Dr. Vusky's at 13 life, that still can be a really strong card. And then he countered that with that creature, and then I Fierce Guardianship, so I don't have to pay for the unpacked. Upkeep cost,
nice.
Yeah, and then that Tioba starts doing things with extra turns.
Oh, here we go, extra turns.
Yeah.
All right, did you foretell this, or did you end up just like doing the all rounds pitch? And we're back. If you couldn't see before, the counterweight on the back of the camera fell, and so did the camera and all of our lights.
It was quite chaotic.
It was insane. It didn't do as much damage as you thought it would, just because, especially since the camera was directly overhead, it missed every crucial thing on the board, which was great. It was just a minor inconvenience that ended up being a pretty funny gag.
Yeah, nothing got broken. But back to the game. This is why everybody's here. So I went to combat, did some damage, I think. Yeah. And then I attack I cast another extra turn spell, Nexus of Fate. So I think Dr. Vusk is like down to one life.
I believe so, yeah. He's just trying to block as well as he can, hoping there's anything. And,
yeah. Dead on
you
board
do have an extra
turn.
This.
Yeah, so he's dead on board. Resting's taking
Resting
a little
thought
bit.
It was He thought he already... He's like, you already took an extra turn. Like, yeah, I have another one. And then he's like, oh, okay.
It's like, no, this is our turn. This is...
Our turn. Right here, Field of the Dead's pretty close to being activated.
Yeah, and I don't think I played more lands either. With those extra turns.
No. Noticeably, Exploration is... it hasn't even really mattered at this point.
Yeah, it hasn't done anything. I do get to draw, like... I think four cards.
Four.
Yeah. Which, you know, for seven, it's kind of bad, but Desperate Times go for Desperate Measures. I did draw one land, and I think this is literally one of the few times I would, like, play a land and then draw a land, and then Exploration, I can play another land. I don't think it affects it because I don't do anything with those two forests. So that's my perspective. You can yell at me in the comments if you like.
I think given the board state of the game with Dr. Vusky being gone and it just being between you and resting, it has an impact, but I don't think it has the potential to have an impact, and I don't think it really had an impact on the game outside of drawing you a card and gaining you a life.
Yeah.
And at this point, it's misplays, but, you know, not one to where it's like this whole rest of this game is invalid.
Call it judge? Judge.
You probably should, man. There were a lot of... I noticed myself there were a lot of misplays on my end.
Oh, yeah. I mean, going, going forward, I make so many like sloppy plays and just mistakes. I miss like, you know, the Field of Dead that's there. Yeah. Completely forget it exists.
It triggered. I don't even know how many more times it triggered. I remember reminding you in the middle of this whole ordeal just between you and Rest. I'm like, you missed a Field of Dead. And he's like, I'm fine. I think you felt bad by how far ahead you were, and just like, oh, he just saw your boy. So you're like, I missed the trigger.
Yeah, I don't know if it's a May, but whatever, irrelevant. Obviously, you know, when you're playing Magic, you should try and best to keep the triggers, you know.
This is CEDH, and we do try to keep it, you know, as well as we can, or as close as we can to being, you know, technically
accurate. Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't want to just, like, make up our own rules, but, you know, when you leave an exploration in the battlefield and you just forget your triggers, and, yeah, not the best role model. But, yeah.
You do have the Bane of Progress here, though. Sick brainstorm art. Love that one. Didn't even know it existed before it flashed on screen.
Would you buy it?
Yeah, I think I'm gonna get rid of the other one. The other one looks cool. It's like a bunch of electric things on the... It's probably one of the characters in the lore. I forgot.
Yeah, probably somebody important. That's okay.
Mm-hmm. So here you have... You have a Bane of Progress. You have pretty good board presence, but he has dragons.
Oh, now I see.
Now you have AC.
Yeah, drawing more cards.
Gaining life through tattoo of a... Yeah. You have AC basically just replaced the exploration.
I think so. What Resting does here is he'll try and play another like artifact or land, and then he can play the Earth Dragon and like swing with three dragons, and you know, draw three cards, put something into the battlefield. So I think that's one of the ways out, right?
Yeah, especially if he gets what's the one, Terror of the Peaks? Like one of the ones, and then he can, you know, pop down your engines. Still a long ways to go to win, but that is a way that he's able to get back into this game. And
yeah, I mean,
having flyers that aren't that big.
And it's not like completely impossible, right? One of the gameplays from a few gameplays ago, like that was kind of what happened.
Mm-hmm.
He went from underneath the, you know, essentially a green blue landfall deck too.
And why don't we just talk about like the... So the Ur Dragon has made a couple of appearances. It mostly due to Resting being a newer player, and this is like essentially, it's synergistic deck. This is essentially his deck, where he'll play it in whenever we play, and he's trying to branch out now. This was like a little side experiment, I guess, that we really didn't even know we were taking. It's just seeing if Yurik Dragon can compete against, you know, one other semi-competitive and then two established like CDH decks at this point.
Yeah, and I did my best, and you can check out that Moxfield deck list down below by the description to, you know, make it as strong as I could. So I added a bunch of tutors. I added a lot of fast mana. It has all the duels, or most of them. So it's like as fast as I could make it, aside from like adding birds and like non-dragon ramp, which I guess could affect it, or...
I guess when you think about it, I mean, here you're going off. Right now it's, you know, extra turns and drawing two cards off of lands. Essentially getting I saw a Consecrated Sphinx in there. He's getting a Consecrated Sphinx trigger off of your two lands every time. It's pretty, I think if Resting was going to win it or come back, it had to be last turn. And unfortunately, I think you're just going to outvalue him at this point.
Yeah.
But he was able to... I think Resting actually got answered a lot in this game. His Rhystic Study, which was like his main out, this is turn one play that he was relying on to get the cards to actually keep going, got countered, and when he was able to get out his Ur Dragon pretty early, it got rapid hybridization, so.
Yeah, unlike the other commanders, right, that it stayed on the battlefield, like the Ur Dragon died on the spot.
The Ur Dragon died on the spot. Rafine, even though it was like the first thing out, was able to... I think, you know, it has its potential, but it's one of the things that we're seeing about the deck, where it's not as resilient. Like, we know to just kill the Ur Dragon and then it's going to have a slow rollback. And here, extra turns, Orkul Modaya. Still no lands, man. How are you feeling about that?
Bro, that land market needs to crash here pretty soon. Good gosh. I think I miss, like, Field of Dead triggers, because I think I have more than 7 different lands with a Misty Rainforest, but...
You do, yeah.
Yeah, nor here nor there. I think, like I said, I was playing very sloppy towards the end, because I have so many cards in hand, I just didn't want to drag it on. Oh, there's Mystic Sanctuary.
This game is sped up a bunch. It was the landfall turns. I like landfall decks. I had a Tatiova deck of my own that I thought was, you know, like a lower casual one, and ends up just being you playing Magic by yourself for 5 minutes.
Yeah. And here I made another mistake. I put Fierce Guardianship into my hand instead of the top of the library. I actually have lands in my hand, so I will be able to, you know, play lands and draw it. Yep. So again,
hey, they're the zombies.
Cool, yeah, there you go. Secret Lair, Walking Dead zombies.
Adventure of Zendikar. Okay, yeah.
So here's that win con. Yeah. So this is how I win the following turn because I don't have haste.
Just looking through your graveyard.
Yeah.
Now here, are you thinking of trying to pump them just in case Avenger of Zendikar dies? Is that where they're just not zero ones?
Yeah, so I play one land, pump them once, and then I think I play another land. And you can say this is via Oracle, Moldiah, or AC. And then I pump them twice. So that's lethal on board for resting. I have a bunch of creatures. So I just need to pass the turn. Like, I went to combat correctly, got my AC kill. That's okay. It's okay.
I think eventually, like, well, given his life total and him not really having a way to, like, you know, gain life like you do, just off of, even if it's very minute, it really matters in the situation. I think sending the big beaters at him is the correct way.
Yeah. And just,
where is your Bane of Progress? How did it die?
I think he sorts of plowshare that.
Oh yeah, you gain life.
Yeah. So Dryad. I think, yeah, Dryad. I think resting goes for the last approach, the last thing he can do, and it's a board wipe. I'm pretty sure that's what he goes for. But as you know, like, I have Fierce Guardianship in hand, and a Force of Negation, so that's not gonna resolve.
Yeah. And you ended up drawing the Fierce anyway. Time. I guess you wouldn't have that.
Flusher Storm Room there, but that's like, yeah.
Again, it's one of those things where it didn't really matter, and you can get sloppy in this game because, yeah, you saw Force of Negation counterspell. There's a whole. He has a whole grip of hands. Also, I forgot the Seagate Restoration. There's really no good way to, like, represent it on board, but you have no maximum hand size, so you didn't have to discard.
Yeah, I had like 15 or 20 cards in hand. Which is, you know, not bad.
So synergistic, how does it feel to sneak under and win another Mystery Commander Theater 100 episode?
Yeah, do absolutely nothing game one.
Oh yeah, game one. This actually is our first game. We decided to try another one where we hopefully didn't make as many mistakes. We thought this one would be pretty good to put out anyway because it's interesting. As I felt like we got to see really big shifts in terms of, like, who was really leading the table, and, you know, everyone. I feel everyone really got to do their game plan, even resting to an extent.
Yeah, and I think the Lance deck kind of did nothing at the start, but then once two players were out of the game, essentially, like, he was able to compete with your dragon pretty quickly.
Yeah. I mean, you can attribute that to bad luck. You were just missing land drops. I don't think it was the
deck itself. Yeah. And I think Raffine was an all-star too. I think she showed how strong she is.
Yeah, I think it might have been stronger out of my hands, which is kind of sad.
But I guess, yeah, we spoiled it. There will be another gameplay of the same decks the following week, so come check us out. Any parting thoughts?
No, none really. I think we really got them there. Raffine's pretty new. I'm excited for how it's going to compete against, you know, a lot of other established decks. It seems like there's a couple different ways that you can take the commander, and I'm happy about that. It means that it can really bend and, you know, like, mold to whatever the meta is.
Yeah, I agree. Well, I think that's it for us. Thanks, folks, for watching. You can check out the deck list down in the description down below. Take care. All right. Now.
Awesome. Have a good one.